We will immediately move on to the next presentation. Alok Mathur.
To share some of my thoughts and maybe some experiences too. The title of my paper is Philosophy in Practice, Reflecting on Krishnamurti's Educational Challenge. Educational questions and challenges in the contemporary world, it seems to me, can be identified at multiple levels. They could focus on the individual or the personal level or the level of the school as an institution. Then there are questions and challenges for the organization and aims of school systems, or scaling up further for education at the national level. There are, of course, in recent decades, more and more issues which are being debated at the international level, as some of our speakers have spoken about. Beyond these, one might also conceive of a global level that encompasses the earth with its multitude of human societies, along with diverse environments and other forms of life. And each of these levels brings up its own valid concerns, questions, and challenges. My paper draws on the educational philosophy of J. Krishnamurti and focuses largely on three of these levels that I have mentioned, that of the human person, the level of the school, and the level of global concerns. The implication of this philosophy, however, has relevance, as I hope to show at the end, for the other levels as well. I begin with the two urgent crises that may be observed as part of the human situation in the contemporary world. The first is that the past century has seen rapid material and industrial development, as well as apparent social progress in many societies. But along with this, again, as other speakers have alluded to, human societies across the globe seem to be riven with increasing conflict and violence. Conflicting identities deriving from nationality, ethnicity, religion, ideology, economic class, in India, caste, language, as well as gender, continue to incite violence in many forms. The second crisis that is upon us is the following. Even as human scientific knowledge is gaining a deeper understanding of the web of complex interconnections that support the rich diversity of life on Earth, it seems that at the same time, human motivations and actions continue to trigger rapid degeneration of all living environments, whether human beings live there or not, I'm including the Antarctica, and alarming extinctions among other living species. These are two contemporary issues that Krishnamurti was deeply concerned with in his lifetime, and he saw these as essentially educational questions. Who is Krishnamurti? For those unfamiliar with his name, I will briefly mention that he was a prominent 20th century spiritual thinker, or philosopher if you have it, who for at least six decades traveled across all continents as a peripatetic teacher, engaging thousands of people in multiple ways. His purpose in doing so was to uncover along with them the underlying factors that shape the human condition and to catalyze the self-awareness that may lead to a renewal in consciousness. Krishnamurti established and nurtured a small number of schools in various parts of the world, five of them in different locations in India and one each in central England and Southern California. His aims for these schools arose directly from his perception and analysis of the common condition of humanity. He saw these schools as centers of inquiry into the human condition, as well as local and global conditions of their times. Thus, from their inception, the schools were seeded with a vision that was open to forms and expressions that were distinctive and pluralistic in character. For example, a residential school located in a drought-prone valley in rural South India would necessarily need to respond to a different landscape and cultural conditions than a school with an international character in the verdant English countryside. An urban school in the heart of a metro city, Chennai, would have quite a different set of issues to negotiate than a school on a riverbank at the edge of the ancient city of Varanasi. Briefly, to speak about the purpose of education and the role of schools in human societies, these have been seen through many different metaphorical lenses, and many of these have been alluded to in the earlier presentations. Schools have been viewed as molds for the reproduction of traditions and social norms, or as a means of transmission of culture. They've also been seen as an arena for nation building, or as opportunities for development and progress of the individual and the collective. In recent decades, more and more schools are being seen as service providers that cater to changing job markets of a globalized economy. However, Krishnamurti saw the schools that he established as spaces for the regeneration of individuals and landscapes, and he proposed that a regeneration of society is consequential to this. Now, what I wish to explore in my paper is the notion of philosophy in practice in schools. It is firstly my contention that any school that attempts to engage with an aims of education that are beyond a purely scholastic or market-driven goal must necessarily evolve a philosophy with a framework of values that lends coherence to its curriculum and practices. More specifically, I will look at this notion as it derives from Krishnamurti's approach to educational questions. When a principal of one of the schools that Krishnamurti started asked him to spell out what were his aims of education, he responded by articulating three central aims. One, cultivation of a global outlook. Two, concern for human beings and the natural environment. And three, an inquiry into all dimensions of human life. These aims taken together generate the essential impetus towards a philosophy in practice, which is seeded into the raison d'etre of these schools. And I believe there are other schools inspired by Krishnamurti, which have also started in different places around the world. As an initial characterization, I see philosophy in practice as acts of responding with authenticity and clarity to oneself, to persons, to situations, to ideas, and to landscapes, as well as to the human condition as a whole. These acts may emanate from simple and direct observation, from clear thinking and reflective practice, from sustained critical awareness, or meditative inquiry, and they may manifest at many levels in the context of schools and education. My contention is that it is this that has the potential of imparting a dynamic, open-ended character to the curriculum, practices, and values that inform the lives of participants in any school. What its multiple expressions might be, and what allows for or inhibits such a philosophy in practice, is something I will take up a little later in my paper. How does Krishnamurti connect such acts at the personal and individual level with global issues? Or what is the essential core of a philosophy that must necessarily emerge and find expression in the educational practice of schools? I'd like to respond to that. Krishnamurti's key insight is contained in an aphorism that he used several decades ago, "You are the world." He affirmed, and I quote, "The content of consciousness is common to all humanity," unquote. At one level, this suggests that every human being participates and contributes to a collective consciousness. We've been speaking about cultural particularities, universality, but this was Krishnamurti's position. What we call individuality, in fact, rests on a layer of culture acquired from tradition and environment, and on this develop personal narratives that give each person a sense of continuity and separate identity. Krishnamurti traces all forms of human conflict and violence to a deep-seated anxiety which has roots in a primordial split that repeatedly occurs in our consciousness. This split manifests as the observer, which is the sense of I or me, and the observed, which are the outward or inward phenomena that the I takes cognizance of. The split also creates a division between recollections of the past, entwined with images of self and others, and projections into the future, as in what might be or what must be. Our social upbringing seldom encourages attention to the present moment, which is the primary source of clarity according to Krishnamurti. As a person grows within a society, a multitude of beliefs, expectations, and socially acquired values imprint themselves in consciousness. The sense of a separate self is shaped not by a single, but multiple identities, each fueled by different social settings, circumstances, and experiences. When these identities are in conflict, as they often are, one experiences inner disharmony. Even when education cultivates the more conscious, that is rational, logical, and critical facilities of the mind, we hardly ever turn around and attend to the undercurrent of inner movements, which manifests as comparison, envy, fear, or anxiety. An inward falling out of harmony is a state that almost all human beings experience, and in this are the roots of violence and human suffering. So, according to Krishnamurti, violence is thus not simply outward acts of violation, of domination and oppression, extending from rape and murder to the horrors of war or genocide, with its brutal or cold-blooded mass killings. And I think the last century has seen much more of this than all the previous centuries put together. It begins inwardly in so-called individuals with conflict and disharmony, and projects outwards when personal identities or group identities are in escalating conflict with each other. Asserting or protecting a particular identity, whether it is of a person, a group, a religious community, or a nation, is a root cause of violence and of injustice in the world. Hierarchies, fueled by comparison, fear, and the urge to dominate, are thus established and sought to be maintained. The human domination of nature and consequent degradation of living environments are also a direct consequence of this inward split and utter separation from nature that is now rampant in the industrial and post-industrial societies across the world. Krishnamurti, however, also affirms that the uniqueness of human beings lies in a capacity for freedom, freedom from this compulsive separation in consciousness. A freedom that allows for the emergence of an authentic individual or authentic personhood. Freedom for him is not the conceptual freedom of an independent, autonomous agent, free to choose and do as he wills, which he sees as an illusion of modernity. He states that, and I quote, "Freedom is pure observation without direction, without fear of punishment or reward. Freedom is without motive. Freedom is not at the end of the evolution of man, but lies in the very first step of his existence. In observation, one begins to discover the lack of freedom, and freedom is found in the choiceless awareness of our daily existence and activity." Unquote. So thus, freedom begins in unmotivated awareness of the movements of one's own thoughts and feelings, when one is not held within compulsive patterns of thought and emotion, sensitivity deepens and takes the mind beyond its limiting boundaries, allowing for spontaneous responses and an expansiveness of the heart. Heart here is a metaphor for the feelings of connection, of responsibility for another, for interflow and reciprocity that is not caught up in static identities that have to be maintained or protected. A deeper inquiry still may negate the self that is socially constructed and uncover a perception of the whole, of one's essential relatedness with humankind and nature. This, to Krishnamurti, is true individuality in the etymological meaning of the word as indivisible. while one's unique character and talents as an individual remain, there is no sense of fundamental separation from others. So developing further on the aphorism, "You are the world," Krishnamurti has this to say, and I quote, "As the representative of the whole human race, your response is whole, not partial. So responsibility has a totally different meaning. One has to learn the art of this responsibility. If one grasps the full significance that one is psychologically the world, then responsibility becomes overpowering love. Then one will care for the child, not just at the tender age, but see that he understands the significance of responsibility throughout his life. This art includes behavior, the ways of one's thinking, and the importance of correct action. In these schools of ours, responsibility to the earth, to nature, and to each other is a part of our education, not merely the emphasis on academic subjects, though they are necessary." Close quote. With this, we return to Krishnamurti's aims of education, which place multiple demands on the real schools that exist and the actual teachers who teach there. While no specialized qualification is required of teachers, Krishnamurti often reiterated that it is first the educator who needs educating, and suggested, "You are human beings first, and then teachers." Early on, he challenged the teachers in his very first school to create an educational approach which was new. And I quote, "I would give the boy or girl the opportunity to be inwardly free and not be a tool of the teacher or of society. It requires a great deal of thinking and organizing to create this new way." Close quote. He, however, did not propose any blueprint of education, any particular design for the curriculum or methods to be followed in schools. And yet these aims translate into a broad framework of values, such as wide-ranging awareness of the world, a sensitivity and concern for others, a sense of beauty and response to nature, a non-competitive attitude, and a spirit of inquiry and questioning. These are intended to inform the curriculum and practices of the schools. And each school, depending on its location, its cultural context, and the talents of specific people who administer it, has interpreted and defined the values and actions that give curricular content and practical form to the daily life of the school. Engagement with context and specific landscapes gives rise to a plurality of responses. Close attention, when it is given to prevailing circumstances and to resources available, has led school administrators and teachers to engage with landscapes and communities beyond the school. To take some examples, a school located in a forested glade at the edge of a dense urban metropolis has shaped its campus into a vibrant center for cultural and aesthetic exploration. And children and adults get attracted here, drawn here from different parts of the country. Another school, located in a drought-prone rural area, initiated reforestation efforts and water conservation practices several decades ago, turning its campus into a tree-laden sanctuary for birds. And in recent times, the school has extended its concerns to include an active engagement with changing agricultural and pastoral practices and the sustainability of rural livelihoods in an era of globalization and global warming. These activities, reaching outwards beyond the school's boundaries, also reach inwards to the school community, modifying its curriculum and influencing the educative experiences of teachers and students in particular ways. This, to me, is one form of philosophy in practice. It draws on a broad framework of values and gives each school a particular character. Within the institutional space of the school community, philosophy in practice must express itself in a variety of other ways too. As mentioned earlier, much thinking and organizing is required to structure and administer a school. The process of communication, of sustaining structures and practices, is an ongoing task. The cyclical, often ritualized routines of school life, however, need to be infused with intention, awareness, and spontaneous actions. For values acquire meaning only when teachers and students express them through their own inquiry and behavior. It is in present awareness that a quality of deeper engagement is evoked. Attention to present moments gives access to the reality and potency of human situations as they arise. This is what might shape a teacher's response to a student's provocative question in class, or the way a house parent, that's the word we use for warden maybe, listens to a parent's expectations of his daughter and responds to these, or the manner in which an administrator deals with an agitated colleague. Depth of present awareness also enables a more nuanced understanding and response to issues of discipline among students as they arise. It is important here to make a crucial distinction between philosophy in practice and philosophy that is put into practice. The latter has the implication of a value framework deriving perhaps from philosophical considerations, which is sought to be given form and content within schools. The impetus for change comes from a scheme outside the actuality of the schools and their situations and seeks to influence and change its practices. However, schools are living institutions, and without inner changes in the actors who make up the school community, efforts to change their ways of being, thinking, and feeling are likely to be met with responses of resistance or mere acceptance, rather than thoughtful responsibility for initiating and sustaining the required change. And much human energy remains locked up in either case. If we take the release of constructive energies as a barometer for meaningful educational change, attempts to put a philosophy into practice often fall short of even the most thoughtfully formulated aims. Hence, philosophy in practice arises in the self-awareness and self-education of the administrator or teacher, even as he is engaged in his daily tasks and interactions. This often begins with discontent with the present situation, and it deepens as the teacher sustains inquiry and finds authentic meaning in his work. The teacher's inquiry may relate to specific issues in the classroom or extend to curriculum and practices in the school that have an effect on learning. The inquiry may encompass the why, the what, and the how of the subjects he teaches. It may be grounded in the need to reach out to students with varied backgrounds, or it may be concerned with the impact of psychosocial influences on himself and his students. So the interchange between teachers and students extends the boundaries of given subject knowledge and may include concerns that lie well outside subjects. For instance, teachers and students could together question habits of mind, critically examine issues of identity, or attitudes towards women in a patriarchal society. They could look at implications of mythical explanations in a traditional society, or discuss the connection between attitudes to nature and consumerist lifestyles. In doing this, they develop their critical sensibilities, begin to understand the influences that shape them, and uncover factors that contribute to violence, injustice, or environmental degradation. Whereas teachers may have more to communicate in terms of knowledge and reasons, the fresh perceptions, questions, or even the innocent prejudices of young people are equally valuable in their mutual inquiry. And underneath all of these inquiries lies an inquiry into oneself. In its fuller meaning, this is an inquiry into human nature and its relationship with the whole. Any school where multiple such inquiries are possible invites the emergence of an evolving philosophy in practice. Now I turn to what factors allow for such philosophy in practice to arise and sustain itself, and what factors inhibit it. Since any such act involves authentic thinking and feeling, a primary condition would be that there be space and opportunity for teachers and students to become aware of their beliefs, thoughts, and feelings, along with an invitation to think on these and to have these challenged. This implies that the structuring of a school as an institution cannot be strongly hierarchical, authoritarian, or very tightly held. At the same time, the space for expression, participation, and initiative needs to be held within a broad framework of values, for this framework sustains cohesion and responsibility, while allowing for autonomy of thought, feeling, and action in participants. Within such reflective autonomy, there may be many an initiative that individual teachers and students may pursue while remaining mindful of its implications for the school community as a whole. So the axis of autonomy-authority is one crucial determinant of the possibility of philosophy in practice. A school tilted too far on one side of the axis towards a restrictive or an all too surely exercised authority would inhibit the freedom to question and think. And I quote, "If the headmaster is dominating, then the spirit of freedom obviously cannot exist," unquote. But on the other hand, an autonomy that is individualistic, without participation in a broadly shared framework of values, could lead to fragmented and chaotic activity. The former is generally the case with large schools manned by a hierarchy of administrators who see their roles as supervisory, as well as schools that are part of highly structured bureaucratic systems. Smaller schools with a progressive intent may swing towards the second situation if there's no guiding framework of values, that is, chaos and fragmentation, though there's also no guarantee that small schools cannot swing to the authoritarian end of the axis. Ultimately, it's the persona, self-perception, and evolving vision of administrators and teachers that are the most crucial factor here. Autonomy and individual initiative in teachers and students is vital for the energizing of a school. But there is another factor equally important that fragments the energy of school communities and inhibits philosophy in practice. This is the factor of comparison and the competitive spirit. This is a subtle and powerful emotion that can readily arise in human relationships, as much among teachers as between students. Competition is an outcome of comparative evaluation, which happens to be the norm in most of our evaluation systems, has been acclaimed to be a spur to purposeful activity, self-betterment, and even excellence. However, once we recognize that this inward comparison effectively masks authentic thinking and feeling, we can see how it would actually narrow our viewpoints and yardsticks. It diverts energies away from genuine engagement with subject matter or any other area of inquiry. Competition is thus detrimental to both critical as well as creative thinking. On the other hand, cooperation, the feeling of thinking and working together, though harder to come by, holds the possibility of inquiring together with others. Whenever such inquiry arises among a group of students, a group of teachers, or teachers and students, who come together to think, plan, and do something meaningful in a school, the impact on them as well as their students can be all the more energizing. We thus have a second determinant, the axis of competition cooperation, which influences the arising of philosophy in practice. School policies as well as attitudes of administrators and teachers are the primary factors in influencing how schools locate themselves along this axis. Institutionalized competition, a hallmark of most modern school systems across the world, narrows learning down to an achievement orientation with winners, losers, pushouts, and dropouts. At another level, administrators or teachers who show marked preferences towards some or who set one person or group against another unwittingly or wittingly encourage competition and comparison of another kind. Both these factors tend to lock the energies of the young and old in petty envies, conflicting emotions, and even feelings of oppression. For a constructive cooperation to be generated in a school, it requires a different kind of arrangement or possibility. Teachers and students need to share their thoughts and concerns often, find common ground with each other, attend to problems through discussion and dialogue, and develop an appreciation and respect for each other. I quote, "To be able to work together in this really cooperative way, we must meet often and be alert not to get submerged in detail," unquote. In the cut and press of daily school life, these opportunities are not easily found, and it needs a longer-term commitment on the part of administrators and teachers, as well as an intelligent structuring of appropriate forums within the school. This may be less difficult in smaller schools, but here too, relationships and communication may get crystallized into set patterns, engendering feelings of inclusion and exclusion. Any school with a serious intent must therefore seek to structure itself to move beyond commonplace barriers between people, such as closely held opinions, biases, and assumptions about each other. Opening up spaces for people to communicate at various levels allows for inquiries that are generated together, as well as decisions and actions that carry a deeper educative impulse. When administrators and teachers come together in this spirit, it makes possible a periodic renewal of structures, of curriculum and practices, and values acquire new and contextual meanings. When parents too become part of the shared concerns, a different kind of energy and atmosphere may be experienced in a school. For philosophy in practice would then have the possibility of becoming a collective enterprise for all those involved in the school. The cumulative effect of supporting such an enterprise is what makes a school a center of inquiry. One may ask, what is the significance or the need for schools as centers of inquiry? As I approach the end of this paper, there are two levels of response I would briefly offer. The first concerns the context of the school and its participants. The second relates to the relevance of such schools for educational reform and renewal on a wider scale. Focusing first at the level of the school, it may be seen that in becoming a center of inquiry, the school would have three kinds of impact. One, as and when it sustains such inquiries, a school is able to evolve values that find actual expression in curriculum and practices. Students would carry the educative impact of these well beyond their life in school. We may hope that they will be able to then meet the practical and moral challenges of the future and live with harmony and balance, thus not adding to the conflict and violence in the world. Secondly, a culture of inquiry is also an impetus for a critical re-engagement with changing realities of the time and the changing challenges of the time, with its emerging socio-political, economic, and environmental problems. If the school and its teachers can respond with a periodic renewal of curriculum and practices, it would enable students to remain in dynamic engagement with these emerging and complex issues, and maybe some of them will find a meaningful direction in life in responding to these. And bringing a quality of intelligence and commitment to their chosen life work, they may actually make a constructive difference in the world. Thirdly, any sustained engagement of this kind also invites an enlargement of the school's own sphere of action and enables participation of persons from the school in wider arenas of social and educational concern. This may be engagement with the local communities or constructive interaction with state school systems, maybe new approaches to teacher education, or contributions to the national discourse on school education. Schools as centers of inquiry have one other significance. It is in and through such schools that practical research into new possibilities in education are undertaken. While being part of wider systemic arrangements, which all schools are in a given society, they are able to maintain a relative autonomy of purpose and a creative dimension in their approach. And this allows for new forms of curriculum and practice to emerge. The school can then serve as a demonstrative space as well as an educational resource center. Their relevance to reform and renewal of school education in the national as well as the international level can hardly be minimized. Finally, I would end my paper by echoing the deep concern that Krishnamurti himself began these schools with. For him, the darkness that threatens to engulf the human situation on earth demands that the schools become centers of light and wisdom, a beacon for the renewal of human consciousness in the 21st century. Thank you.
my presentation. And what makes it very inspiring is, of course, that it's already in practice, and what you are reflecting is actually on the practice which you are doing. The only question which comes immediately is that it shows very, very sensitive handling of the values, actually not only handling, one should say nurturing of values that Krishnamurti upheld, and now people who want to extend that philosophy, they are upholding and they are nurturing it in that environment, in that system, with children, with teachers, with administrators, and so on. So the only question which comes is, can it ever be upscaled in quotes, in senses where such sensitive, dynamic, creative nurturing is constantly from minute to minute not available? And can it actually translate to, let's say, you are saying teacher education or state systems or curriculum design?
Process and probably can happen. Not sure where to begin responding to that. I don't think schools which are actually pursuing an inquiry which rests on the human condition can remain isolated entities. They have to spill beyond their boundaries. And I think this happens in many different ways. One part of my paper which I was attempting to show is that I think these are actually relevant factors for any school. They're not just for some school. These are all human factors which are interpenetrating the functioning of any school. Schools, have, you know, from certain perspectives, begun to receive a very bad press. The schools are places where, you know, conditioning happens, where social norms are, you know, reinforced, as many examples have come about. So I think a demonstration that schools can be something more than that, I think is a very important and very valuable thing to be able to attempt. And I'm using the word attempt because none of these schools are actually ideal or perfect, or, you know, it's not so sensitive always. There are many factors, as I mentioned, competition, cooperation. They are moving between all of these axes. But I think the attempt to do that, I think, shows many possible directions to any school. And in fact also, I mean, just to share some facts of the matter, practices and curriculum evolved in these contexts, in the rural education center at Rishi Valley, for example, are now influencing or affecting state school systems in many, many states in the country. So ideas can be taken and recreated in other places too. I think also it's a matter of what happens to individuals who either, you know, work and think these things through, whether they are students or whether they are teachers. And when people go out, they carry with them, you know, their own questions, inquiries, and try to make a difference. So I don't know, I've sort of meandered around the response to your question. But I think any such school, and I'm not talking only about schools started by Krishnamurti, any school which has some kind of a philosophical basis where people are inquiring, where people are trying to engage with the reality of the situation around them and are keeping the larger human situation in mind, will have that kind of impact. And I think, many people said, education needs to be turned on its head. I think it's when schools are able to do something, some small thing, that the possibility of that becomes evident, that it can happen.
Station Alok, I had a question. You talked about Krishnamurti's philosophy on human beings and the natural environment. To me, the natural environment is not only the physical, whether it's drought-prone or a forest, but it's also the social of the people who are there, the kind of socio-economic engagement that's going on. When your students come from outside that environment into these environments, do you think it's conflicting? Because really they're in an artificial environment. The environment is only the physical space. It's not really engaging with the social aspects and other aspects and the cultural aspects of that space. And how then do you see, when you're talking about say, you know, planting trees or working on the drought-prone area, how does it not become like environmental determinism is only the physical space that you're looking at? And is this a conflict when you're talking about philosophy in practice?
No, I would differ with you, Bindu, on one count, that I think that these schools are not artificial spaces. They are very much embedded both in the physical, natural, as well as a social environment. All schools are. No school is, you know, cut away from the social. There's a social environment within the school. There's a social environment outside the boundary of the school. And I think there's a lot of learning of different kinds which goes on about human relationships, human interactions, both within the school and with communities outside the school, which is possible. But I think that also need not be separated from the natural environment, because I think the two have a very close juxtaposition. The natural environment is the basis on which all other forms of human life also exist. So I think trying to see all these interconnections and being able to see them in an educated way is, I think, what would give a certain integrated understanding wherever you go. And I would sort of agree with some of the thoughts expressed in the paper on cosmopolitanism, that you should be able to engage with realities. If you look deeply enough in your own local situation, you should be able to engage with realities in any new situation. Be sensitive to new realities, understand its cultural evolution, see what the issues are, be able to engage with that. That's at least, I would say, the educative hope, the hope of education. Otherwise, yes, what are schools for? You know, you create some hothouse environment, as someone used the term, and then out of the hothouse, the plant wilts. It needs to, I think, gain deep roots and be able to transplant itself in different places, to use a metaphor.
Arora, thanks for making it imaginable, and this possibility of generating alternatives is really very important. I have one question, because what you portrayed and what I've seen in one of the schools, J. Krishnamurti schools, is that though it's teachers and educators play a very crucial role. J. Krishnamurti also said that first the educator has to be educated, and then education of the students can proceed. So the appropriateness or suitability of the educational process will really depend on how teachers are. But I have missed listening to what is done to make such educators or teachers in these schools. I would like to know that. Thanks.
Which is, of course, covering many issues. But I think I mentioned somewhere that at least from Krishnamurti's point of view, he didn't require any specialized qualification for his teachers, which, however, unfortunately, has now become a necessity in the country, that you have to have a specialized qualification to join school education. I think the way this philosophy approaches it is that every human being is given the way he is, the way he has grown. It's when you become aware and alert to your own situation that you can begin to take responsibility for yourself. And I think the attempt here is that teacher can take responsibility for himself, for his own self-education. And it's not something which is a process prior to educating students. It's something which happens alongside with students. In fact, I think that's one of the greatest attractions of the teaching profession, to be with young people and to be, in some sense, challenged by them, to also be related to them and actually learn a great deal in one's interaction with them. So I think it's children who teach a lot to teachers. But of course, teachers have to be open to that self-learning, and I think that's the process which the school tries to encourage. Of course, along with that, pedagogy, curriculum, understanding the subject, all of that is important too. But I think the primary thing is how does one awaken this self-learning in the teacher along with the student?
Yeah. The first thing I'd like to do is to echo the some of the comments of previous people who have spoken here. I thought that was a splendid presentation. It was very, very clear, very articulate, and very moving, I thought. And one of the first things I'll do when I get back to snowy Edinburgh is to look at the works of Krishnamurti. Very inspiring. I'm in danger here of echoing some of the problems raised by the first who responded to your talk. The general question of what we do with this more generally, where we would actually the context of. I think it's all very well responding to the first question that, there are aspects of this philosophy that can be pursued more widely in other contexts. But I think that the power of this view actually is that it's driven by a very specific metaphysical anthropology I find actually extremely attractive. It has resonances with a lot of Western mysticism, Christian mysticism, Christian Gnosticism, Rudolf Steiner philosophy, for example, other kinds of perspectives and philosophies elsewhere, but they are highly specific. I'd certainly like to have children acquainted with something of Krishnamurti's work in any educational context, but it's difficult to see how you could have schools run in general on these kind of lines, because obviously it is a very partisan perspective. It's a very particular perspective. So I just wondered if you'd say a little bit more about that. But I love the talk. Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir. My own view is that it is not actually such a partisan perspective. Because I think the way he's analyzed the human condition and so on, maybe people have other ways of analyzing it. But I see a lot of general relevance of what I would consider the impulse to learning, the impulse to inquiry, the impulse to find out. I think somewhere that lies at the heart of all education, anywhere. And I think that has general relevance anywhere. And apart from that, I think understanding certain basic human social factors, I think the speaker before me also talked about it, that human living is collaborative. Human living is also autonomous. I think these are very general perspectives and values which are shared very widely. And I think it's not, to me, such a partisan perspective. It's something which could be applicable to any culture within any society. And one could draw, different forms and shapes out of it. I think that's the other point I wanted to make through my talk, that this inquiry-based approach, which looks at the context, looks at the local culture, looks at the communities you're interacting with, also keeps in mind a broader perspective, can actually find different expressions anywhere in the world. And different school systems, different modes of education might emerge. That's my response, provisional.
I'm sorry. I wish to share a sense of discomfort, personal discomfort, listening to your excellent presentation. And that is, I want to allude to what I would like to refer as the Duryodhan complex. For those who are not familiar with the Mahabharata, Duryodhan was the great anti-hero, in fact, probably the prime mover in the conflict between the Kauravas and the Pandavas. Krishna is supposed to have tried to teach him or preach to him about morality, at which point Duryodhan says, "Krishna, don't tell me anything about morality. I know it better than you. But what do I do about my predisposition to do evil?" I believe that just as everyone has a sense of good or an evil, there is also a sense of an ability to do evil present in every man. And I don't know if the kind of experiences you are sharing, or rather I would like to know if there is any evidence that the kind of actually reduces the level of people to inflict evil on others. If you look at educated societies, I don't see any evidence that education necessarily leads to lessening of evil in private, in public domains.
Yes, I think as a general proposition, I would completely agree with you that education per se doesn't shift the propensities which we carry within us and which are also socially constructed within us. But I think here we are looking at, I think, a deeper meaning of education. And I think it's an education which is in fact exactly trying to respond to this disturbance and discomfort which we all feel, that there is so much, for all the good that man has done, humankind has done, there is so much sorrow, so much evil, so much destruction that has been also created. So why has that happened? There have been layers and layers of different forms of education which we have been sort of evolving and developing and so on through the centuries. So is there a way? Is there a way to get to the root of that? And I think a word that I didn't mention at all through my talk because I thought it might distract is that fundamentally I think Krishnamurti saw these schools as places for religious inquiry. I said all forms of human inquiry. And I think somewhere that's one thing which has got a very bad press in India particularly because religion is associated with superstition very often. But there is something which is beyond a particular historical or superstructure of religion, which is somewhere also seated in human nature. This is my belief and assumption, which allows things to become integrated, which allows for some, at a deep level, a resolution of this dichotomy, this duality within us, which is the good and the evil. And for Krishnamurti, he traced it down eventually to the split between the observer and the observed. That we inherently have, humankind has sort of developed our thought process in such a way that we are constantly separating ourselves inside. And that creates conflict, and conflict creates its own energy of disturbance. That energy of disturbance expresses itself in acts of violence. First, violence to oneself, and that then projects outwards and moves to violence to others. And in collectives and groups, it becomes violence on a large scale and evil on a large scale. So I think it's still an open question. Is there an education which can free us of this tendency to violence? I would say it's an open question. Yeah, I wouldn't say that there's any guarantee for any form of education to free us of that.
Yeah, I see that there are far more number of hands than we can accommodate in the remaining space. So we have just maybe three more people. And arbitrarily, if you would pardon me, Rohit there, and the gentleman there in the black T-shirt. And actually, this gentleman has been waiting a long time. And can we stop with that, please?
Yeah, Alok, I'm more or less will be expressing a similar kind of discomfort which David and Vijay already have expressed, but maybe in slightly different language, and you don't need to answer that. Maybe I have missed the answer. It seems to me that the philosophy hinges on special meanings given to self-awareness, authentic thinking, authentic feeling, these terms. In the ordinary language, how to define these terms, perhaps it will hinge on that. If not, then perhaps there is an assumption that human beings are essentially good, and left free to express themselves, only the goodness will emerge. Not only goodness, but it seems that they necessarily has some epistemic impulse also. Therefore, the knowledge is also inherent in their nature, which will come out. The third assumption which can through which this can hang together is some sort of ethical and epistemic intuitionalism, which is very close to the second. It seems to me that without this kind of assumptions, the guarantee that a self-aware community of teachers will create a school which essentially will generate these kinds of values which will be accepted and will take the inquiry as well as humanity in a desired direction seems to be very difficult. So it seems that it's fundamentally some sort of faith at the root of it, perhaps in either human goodness or inherent knowledge somewhere. Thank you.
Thank you, Rohit, for posing so many different possibilities which I hadn't considered. I would respond to partially what you said. I may not be able to give a full response, but I would say that the second assumption which you said I don't think holds in this case, that there is essential goodness in human beings. I think human beings are conflicted, is a conflicted kind of animal. It's quite different from other animal species in some sense, who don't have all those inner problems and so on. And so the expression can take multiple different forms. So as I said, it's an open question for me still. But I think there is maybe some kind of, what the last thing you said, some kind of faith that if one persists, it going to the root of where this conflict emerges, where this dichotomy and split in the human responses emerges, maybe there is something different that can happen, which is more whole, more integrated, if not good. Maybe good too.
Alok, what... I have been puzzled with K's work is what is the stance vis-a-vis social change and critical theory. One can see a spillover effect of you being a good individual and then you kind of touching many lives and then it going in that fashion, but for some of the impatient ones would see a lot of value in a leftist or a Marxist kind of a revolutionary social change. So do you see a possibility of a large scale social change happening through an education system like this, or would it be like an osmosis, a gradual one?
It's a very difficult question for me to. The first part, I think, is relatively easy. Yes, I mean, I think if there is a change in one person, it has a ripple effect of some kind. I think, however, this is not only about, harmony and goodness and so on. I think it's also about critical engagement with social realities, political realities, economic realities. And I think that's where, a school needs to be able to seed into its own curriculum critical processes too. And with that, there may be individuals who come out, but the school doesn't take a definitive stance or a direction. I think that would be fatal, that we all must do this in order to bring social change. I think different individuals will respond differently, and some may engage with the more impatient kinds of activity which you spoke about, which are moved by injustice and moved by situations where they feel they need to intervene. At the same time, if they don't do it with a degree of, and this is something which is anecdotally I've often heard, that people who take just an activist stance actually themselves acquire a lot of conflicting energy. And either there's a burnout or there's oppositional forces get set in motion, and what you were actually trying to correct gets also reinforced. There's a mirroring of some kind. So if, as you're engaged in some active engagement with a certain situation if you're not also watching yourself, also watching how your reaction to that situation is shaping you and how it's sort of entering you, it may not be, you know, very effective, if I may just put it that way.
Just to wanted to also express my discomfort, but probably with the word practice. And when we practice a philosophy for long, we have got many epistemologists among us, we can ask them, it probably gets converted into ideology. And when it gets converted into an ideology, we tend to label other ideologues as impatient and with negative energies. I don't know whether Krishnamurti would have wanted his philosophy to be practiced in the sense that it gets converted into ideology. With the similar stance, if we are practicing philosophy, how we approach other philosophies? Was just wondering that how people respond to Freire or Giroux or Marxian idea of writing about anything, or how people compare with other thinkers' idea of philosophy. Aurobindo also had a philosophy, they also practiced it. Ramakrishna Paramahans also had. And probably Talibans also have a philosophy, and Thackeray also had a philosophy. So if we practice that philosophy for a long, what would be A, your take on it? And B, which is quite easier to tell, what Krishnamurti's take was on that. Thank you.
And I'll maybe respond to the first and what you came back to at the end. What does it mean to practice a philosophy? And does that then become into a particular form of action which is self-reinforcing and acquires its own justification and therefore becomes a kind of an ideology, right? So maybe I'll first start with what I think might have been Krishnamurti's take on it. I think one of the things which probably Krishnamurti was very careful in not doing was to actually suggest any practice. He never gave any methods, guidelines, you know, your curriculum should be this, or this is how you should teach. I think things were at a very, very, I mean, in fact, I was reflecting on John White's paper, very high level aims. Now you find your practice out of that. First of all, you have to see whether those aims make sense to you. If those aims make some sense to you, or if you're drawn to them, then you find your own practice. And I think that's where it might differ from something which becomes an ideology. There is no recommended, suggested practice.